several times.
So oh, nice to hear. Nice. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so hello, everybody. Thanks for coming for this talk. We will start this talk with Professor Eric Klumperin talking about interference robust multiband CMOS radio receivers. Professor Klumperin, I will not talk much about him because we all know him, right? I mean, he's a very known fellow in ISCC and in this RF area from the 20 University in the Netherlands. A few comments. Please use the chat at YouTube to make questions and then to interact with the other participants. And also fill out our form just to show that you are there to help us to keep a track of the attendance of the group. Thank you very much for coming. Now I hand over for Professor Eric. It's a pleasure really to have you here. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for the invitation to give me the opportunity to give this talk. And this talk covers interference robust radio receiver techniques. And there is also an virtual journal paper on that, in which you can also find most of the references that I will be talking about, especially the older ones. First, maybe you may wonder, where is Twente? If you look on the map, you maybe not find it. Actually, it's an old area, an old name for an area. And Twente is in the Netherlands, that's this country here. And we are then in Enschede, the city in the east, close to the German country. And there's a university there, technical university. And our IC design group is very active in high frequency circuit design and also baseband circuit design. So the talk today will be about flexible radio architectures. So I will start with an introduction here. Talking about these interference robustness receiver architectures and their requirements. And then I'll split it up in two parts, one about broadband linearization techniques and the other about more filtering narrowband techniques. And the subdivisions will become clear later on. And at the end, I will go through some innovative recent directions, but I will focus a bit on the basics to get a deeper understanding of how modern radio receivers work. These modern radio receivers are everywhere in all our telephones, and if you think about it, yeah, there is somewhere a chip inside those telephones connected to an antenna, and it's actually a miracle to see how many radio interfaces there are built in. You have the old-fashioned GSM, we have Bluetooth, we have GPS, Wi-Fi, there are lots of UMTS bands, 4G LTE bands. They even started numbering them from 1 to 76, and for 5G even more bands are coming up. So there's a lot of radios inside, and that makes it also very impractical to just build individual radios, and that's why we targeting reconfigurable, so-called programmable or software radio techniques. Then a bit about the historical motivation that has been shifting from single radio devices to multi-radio devices. And the main force behind it is the growth of wireless that exceeded the capabilities, because the spectrum was kind of filled up, as you see here on this plot. And the information capacity is quite close to the Shannon capacity. So then the targets are changing. So the efficiency of the use of the spectrum is really the most important thing. And then small cells are the way to go. And massive MIMO, that's a recent thing. Already quite some years now. But that has been pushing the spectral use. And then if you think about the transceivers, what's in it, a transmitter and a receiver. Transmitter that should be very linear to reduce interference to others, and a receiver that should cope with strong interference. So overall, we want a flexible receiver, and this talk will mainly be on the receiver side. And the key point is then, there are so many other radio devices where in the past you may be noise limited, now we are really interference limited by all these interfering devices. So what do we roughly need when it comes to the performance? Then we can start with KT, the well-known noise floor. That's this number here in dBm, where 0 dBm meets 1 milliwatt, and a dB scale is used. And then we need some practical noise figure and a certain typical bandwidth of 10 megahertz is often used. So then we end up with a round number of minus 100 dBm as the noise floor in 10 megahertz. That's then the low side of the dynamic range. On the other hand, at the upper side, at the antennas, you sometimes receive signals up to 0 dBm, 1 milliwatt, which means that we need about 100 dB clean range, signal to noise and distortion ratio. And if we assume 6 dB per bit for an ADC bit, that means about 17 bits. And for a radio spectrum up to 6 gigahertz, that's really too tough. So that's why you would end up here in the upper corner at the yellow star, where we have that resolution and that and enough bandwidth. If feasible at all, actually, there are no A2Ds with so many bits at those frequencies. But even if you take optimistic assumptions, easily a kilowatt in power would be dissipated. So we don't like that, of course. And that means we need something up front the ADC, namely frequency down conversion and filtering. And then you can go to the green region where the number of bits is maybe in the 12 to 14 range, and the ADC speeds are in the region of a few hundred megahertz to gigahertz, something like that. So what will we often do? We tend to still start with some passive bandpass filter, and then select the band in that way, amplify, mix down, and then do baseband filtering, and then the ADC. So then, if we make all these things programmable, you could say it's a software-defined radio. If we move it all to the ADC, a software radio, these terms are a bit used interchangeably sometimes. And if we now historically look at what's happening, about 100 years ago, we had Armstrong, which made his radio receiver proposal with lots of LC things. And now our dream is more or less to move it all to digital, to the digital DSP. But that means that ADC will become a very hot thing. And then to still make that ADC feasible, we put something up front. So the trend is from analog to digital, but analog is still needed. We want flexibility. That means less dedicated pre-filtering, because we want to receive different frequencies and we can't use fixed external filters. And then the architectures developed, pushed by this, are known under different names like surface acoustic wave less, SAW less architectures, or inductor less or wideband, because many signal bands are radio bands are covered. Reconfigurable, cognitive radio, software defined radio, these are all names used for the architectures developed to make this possible. And the key point that I will focus on are then the flexible techniques to improve the receiver linearity, the small signal linearity, which is characterized by so-called intercept points IIP2 and IIP3. High IIP2 and 3 means very linear. And you could say then, because noise is becoming less important, we often do that at reasonable noise figure, let's say below 6 dB or something. Also, we want to handle large signal blockers, very strong blockers, and then we need high compression points and also good noise figure under blocker conditions. Blockers are very strong interferers. So then the noise figure should not become too high, maybe 10 dB or so, or is still acceptable, but not a lot more. And then overall, of course, we like to reject interference So filtering and canceling or selectivity is very important. Now a bit about the interference robustness requirements. So this could be a typical radio spectrum where there is a green signal that we like and the rest is interference. So clearly we don't want then, due to nonlinearity, all kinds of other signals overshadowing this green one. So high linearity is then very important. And we need to handle very small and weak signals. Of course, we would like to filter, but yeah, what is possible? There are limits to that. And a typical traditional filter would use inductors and capacitors. So here, very nice old-fashioned inductors and capacitors that can have a nice narrowband characteristic, so very nice selectivity and highly linear. So in that sense, we like it. And we can tune it if we can tune, for instance, the capacitor. For instance, that would be possible. However, the inductor has resistance and parasitic losses to, in the substrate and coupling to others. So here you will see there are also limitations to this approach, and especially the low inductor quality factor, about maybe 10 up to a few gigahertz, that limits the bandwidth. So if we have 1 gigahertz, a Q of 10 would mean 100 megahertz bandwidth. So certainly we cannot filter then a 1 megahertz channel. Band selection is still okay, and it's nicely linear, but it's not for filtering the channels. Now, given the limited Q, let's say below 15 in practice, at higher frequencies, and limited tuning range, this has only a limited use. It's very useful when you can use it, but it's certainly not enough. What has commonly become the solution to address this problem is the so-called zero IF receiver, where you have a mixer that takes the input frequency and mixes with an LO frequency essentially equal to the FIN to zero frequency. So the green wanted signal at FIN is then moved down to baseband. That's actually what happens then. And by low pass filtering, the orange filter here will then select the wanted signal and the sum frequency that you also produce with mixing. You always mix to a sum and a difference frequency, and that is then filtered out. And this is good to relax the requirements on the ADC speed because it's now in baseband and the filter queue is relaxed a lot after pre-filtering. However, there are also challenges. So you may note now that green is always the good, the gray clouds are the potential troubles. And things that are troubling are the LO signal, which is huge, may be radiated out and come back. That is a problem for zero IF. And also that's called LO leakage, local oscillator leakage. And the other thing is the oscillator, here indicated in blue, the oscillator LO signal, will have phase noise around it. That's this blue skirt around it, that phase noise sideband coming from thermal noise integrated in the oscillator typically. And that is then mixed around the green signal. And that in itself is not yet a big problem. But if you now also have an interferer, that red signal here will also mix with the phase noise and will then overshadow the green signal. So that is actually a very important problem for interference robustness. Strong red interference signal mixing with the blue phase noise signal. And then that gives poor noise figure. And that's called blocker noise figure because the red signal is very strong, a blocker signal. Now a bit more about the dynamic range and playing around with it, where we assume an attenuation 1 over A, where A is bigger than 1, and afterwards an amplification. And then we take a receiver with these typical performance numbers, a noise figure of 4 dB and a 0 dBm pretty decent third order intercept point. That's a sort of third order distortion number and a bandwidth of 10 MHz. Then if we apply this true input, so the green circles are now the true input signals, many tones, we will see that the output is distorted, and these red signals are the distorted signals. If A is not big enough, because then the signals to the amplifier are too strong, or to the nonlinear system. So then you can make A bigger, so more attenuation, and then there's no distortion problem anymore, but there is a noise problem. Now the noise floor has gone up here to from minus 100 to minus 60 or so. So that's also not nice. And then there is a compromise. That's the optimum attenuation, gain A, where you get the best compromise between the two. And then you get a certain clean, spurious free dynamic range, also called intermodulation free dynamic range, for third order distortion in this case. And that can be calculated with this formula here. And actually, the purpose of automatic gain control in a radio is to maximize this range. So to get a good compromise between the third order distortion and the noise. And then what is wanted for the receive chain is high IP free, so very low distortion, and low noise figure. And you can see they are both in the same way in the equation. But because noise figure is already typically very low, let's say 3 dB, well, then there are only a few dBs left. You can say there's more room at the top. So better push than the linearity to get a better spurious free dynamic range. And this is what this talk will be about a lot. Now a bit more about which distortion is important. We can have second order and a third order distortion, which turn out to be both relevant. For zero IF receivers. Second order gives the sum and difference frequency. So squaring any signal gives the sum and the difference frequency, second order nonlinearity. And then if you have two red tones here, these two, the difference frequency here is in baseband, and that could be problematic, but there's an easy solution to that, because if you put an AC coupling capacitor here, you can just filter that out. Also note that any AM modulation at a high frequency via the square law, second order nonlinearity, will move to baseband. So that is, IIP2 should really be good for zero IF receivers. Now, this is the narrowband case when the two signals are close, the interferers. If the interferers are further spaced, but we have a wideband system, still the tone could be, and two-port tone could be in-band, then it becomes even more challenging, because then you also need an high IP2 LNA, whereas in the top case, the improve the capacitive coupling solves the LNA problem, and then the mixer is actually the issue. So the mixer IIP2 is then the challenge, but mixers can be very good in IIP2, especially if you make them symmetrical. And in the lower case, the wideband case, the LNA should be also linear. Now, what are the requirements? Let's take some typical numbers. Let's take the noise floor we calculated before, the minus 100 dBm, and keep the distortion products below that noise floor. Then you can fill in some basic formulas, and you find that the more the interference power, the higher the requirement on IP3. And typically, you might go to this minus 10 to 0 dBm. So you need easily 60 dBm IIP2 for your receiver. And for IIP3, IIP2 should then easily be up to 80 or even 100 dBm if you would go to 0 dBm, but often we stick to minus 20, and then maybe minus 60 is enough. Whereas here for IP3, 20 would be okay. But if you have no filtering upfront and you would go to 0 dBm, then you really come to crazy specs like 60 dBm IP3 and 100 dBm IP2. And that's in general not feasible. So we want very high linearity receivers, as good as possible, but what is feasible? Let's see. And let's go through some techniques. So one technique is negative feedback that you probably all know. And you know likely also that if you do basic calculations with the A beta, you can find these equations and you can find that the second order and third order distortion coefficients are reduced by the 1 plus A beta. Thus, the more A is, the more gain, the better the linearity. However, also notice that the second order coefficient A2 squared messes up the third order distortion. So this is really a worrying thing in quadratic MOSFET devices. So these techniques are useful in baseband, I would say, when you have lots of gain, but at high frequencies, they are tricky to use and there are some pitfalls there. Often we use then open loop circuits like simple MOSFETs. And then the MOSFET is more or less quadratic or a bit more linear if you go to the modern MOSFETs. And if you take now the derivative, if it were a perfectly quadratic MOSFET, you expect a linear first order derivative, G1 here. So then the green line would be the behavior, but you see also second order effects like mobility reduction making a bend off. But here it's still more or less quadratic. The second derivative has a peak then, here somewhere in the middle. And the third order derivative has, interestingly enough, a point in the middle where IM3 is zero. So that is the sweet spot where you would like to be. However, due to spread in process, voltage and temperature, this point will move around a bit and then you don't hit that point. And also, if you really swing the signal here a bit bigger, then you go through these bumps and you get fifth order distortion and other higher order distortion, which is not so nice because it's a sweet spot. Now, there is a trick, derivative superposition, where you bias two transistors somewhat differently by two bias voltages. And then you can play around and make sure that the sum of the derivatives of these two transistors add up to a more or less constant region here in the middle. So now you don't have a sweet spot, but a sweet region. And that is typically used a lot to make very linear open loop circuits. Still, there is PVT spread as a risk. An even nicer technique is to not do this with two NMOS, but also use complementary devices, and then you can show that you can even address then the second order derivative G2, which in this case would be quite strong in the blue case, but in the green case now gets a sweet spot again. So then with the combination of the techniques, especially this inverter is really nice. It can have a very good linear region and also a sweet spot for the second order distortion. And this is really a very popular technique, but PVT spread between the P and MOS is a worry. Now let's have a look at transconductors and how to optimize them. You might wonder then maybe why transconductors? Well, one reason is that I have been working on transconductors, but that's of course not a very good objective reason. But transconductors are really nice. They are very fast circuits. They can work up to many gigahertz. So very fast. They can be accurately matched. They have a huge GM range when you scale them with bias and width. And they have electronic tunability by changing the bias point. And also very simple circuit implementations like a single transistor can be a transconductor or maybe degenerated or a PN pair or an inverter or things like that. Differential pair, of course, all are transconductors. And then you might wonder why transconductor at RF? Well, these are some of the blocks you can make with it. GMC integrators for filters, wideband amplifiers for LNAs, bandpass filters with an LC tank, a gyrator for a filter, an oscillator with a negative GM, a GM with a mixer behind. So pretty much all you need for RF. Now, what did I find in this thesis? I found all graphs of two transconductors combined in a circuit. And it turns out there are 145 different graph topologies, so different topologies between an input port and an output port. That means hundreds of thousands of circuits, because each of these transconductors can be made in different ways with NMOS, PMOS, differential pair, whatever, times the 145 graphs. So we're talking about a lot of circuits. Some cancel noise and distortion. I will show some examples later, but this was the way how we came to that idea. Also, then the purpose of this work was to find the best spurious Fresnel grains, because we know that's important. And then per power, because we know that any circuit that is scaled up can have better signal noise ratio, because the effects average out, but has also more power. So then you have to normalize to be fair. And I don't want to go into the details, but this is a way to do a fair comparison. Take this spurious Fresnel grains per power, or the normalized signal noise ratio, so which are related. And then what I found was the best circuits are a quadratic MOSFET in strong inversion, or a degenerated with resistor degenerated MOSFET. And all other transconductors working in triode, weak inversion, or bulk driven are worse for some reason. You can find it in a paper. And also nice to know, there is a maximum of this normalized signal noise ratio if you have some assumptions of staying within the supply in class A. And then you find this graph for a single transistor with a maximum. This is the maximum normalized signal noise ratio that you can get. And then also you can make lots of circuits like differential pairs, like inverters. And those can be classified. And I don't want to talk too much about how that was done, but it's based on the Kirchhoff relations that you enforce by voltage and current sources. And then the best circuit that you find actually turns out to be the inverter again. So this gives you some proof from systematic searching all topologies that inverters are really one of the better circuits to make V2I conversion. Now this noise and distortion cancellation that I just mentioned that came out of this systematic circuit generation. So how could we make an LNA? We often do that by common gate stage, which is a wideband 1 over GM input impedance circuit. So it can be driven by a source then, and we have then a nice broadband matched reasonable noise figure single out LNA. If we now add a common source stage and we design it properly, we can also make in this way a balun. So then here you have just a single input sine wave, and here you have a differential output available as the differential output signals, which is good because there's a lot of interference of digital on CMOS chips. Now, the noise of this common gate transistor normally creates the noise figure problem, and that current of the noise source flows like indicated, and produces two voltages, one at the drain and one at the source side, which have opposite polarity. And this lower voltage is sensed by the common source transistor and then inverted again. And now you see at the output common mode noise, and differentially, nothing will come out. So what we have now is we made impedance matching with a resistive device or a transconductor device of equivalently 50 ohm, 1 over 20 millisiemens. However, we cancel its noise, so we are no longer limited to this 3 dB noise figure. Actually, what are we limited to? Well, that depends on how we scale that common source device. So typically, we give that then a bigger GM, and then we can find this equation for the noise figure. Noise factor, and then in dBs, that's a noise figure, and we can keep the noise below 3 dB or close to 3 dB, whatever we like. And also, what you can show is that any distortion current, which can be modeled here, is also cancelled. So we get simultaneous a balun with noise cancelling and also distortion cancelling option at the common gate device. And this has become a very popular technique. The common source is then the important device for nonlinearity, and then traditionally we model this with just a And it turns out that this gets more and more complicated when you go to modern technologies. Actually, it's funny to see that the derivatives, the first order gain peaks here at a certain value, which means that there is a sweet spot in IP2, second order distortion, which means that the quadratic term here is canceled by, yeah, by what? By other terms. And it turns out if you dig into that, it comes from cross terms between VGS and VDS, X11. So the drain voltage swing is really also very important in modern MOSFET devices. And that's also true for the third order distortion. There are also two cross terms here. And the design conclusion that you can draw from this is keep that cross term low by keeping the VDS swing low. In other words, try to design your circuit such that the drain swing is low. Now let's go to frequency translated active filtering. And as an intro, let's talk about the compression problem that we have for strong signals. If we have a 0 dBm signal, we can calculate in 50 ohm that it is about 0.6 volt, that's that peak. And a typical supply is not much higher, maybe 0.8 volt now. So that means, or what, if we are optimistic, maybe 1.2 volt, even with 2x gain, the red signal would already, the amplified signal would already clip to the supplies. Essentially, that means you cannot do any LNA gain before filtering. So you first need to filter. And if you don't do that, you get compression because then this signal starts clipping. And that means the gain starts varying from this slope to this slope. And that gives very bad results, namely cross modulation. The blocker modulation is transferred to whatever signals you have in the amplifier. You get higher order distortion terms, fifth, seventh, whatever. All kind of terms come up. And the noise figure goes down because the noise figure becomes very bad because the gain goes down. You are blocked. So blocker noise figure is then very poor and the important property to watch. Now, what can be done against that? Avoid RF gain. And we propose to do that by not doing an LNA with voltage gain, but only a V to I conversion, because that's still allowed. And then avoid swing at the drain, because then the cross terms can be kept low and the third order distortion can be low. And then essentially only in baseband here, do with an op-amp-like circuit, the I to V conversion of a current to voltage together with filtering, because there can be baseband capacitors available to do the filtering and then the gain simultaneously. And now what you get is here at RF only V to I conversion. So then we have here not an LNA, but an LNTA. The T stands for transconductance, GM. And then we have a mixer. And then we have the virtual ground node of this op-amp, which is very low ohmic. So node D here is very low ohmic in band. And yeah, then the op-amp gain drops and it tends to go up. But out of band, if we put here a capacitor, it can also go down again. So then we have actually pretty low virtual ground impedance for a wide impedance, a wide frequency range. And then the mixer mixes that up to node B here, which is the drain node of the, for instance, the inverter LNTA. So now the node B does not see much swing. And in that way, you can get a very good linearity receiver. And here you see the main limitations. In band, you get just the gain of about 34 dB. And then at some point clipping because the output clips to the supply. Then the next limitation will be the in-band IP3, which is here 3.5 dBm. That is because in-band there is gain and third order distortion. And at some point you also get clipping. You see it here, the compression coincides with the high third order distortion. And then out of band, you can get a much better result, the green one here. out of band, the op amp has attenuation, and then the V2I converter determines the linearity, and which can be, if well designed, an inverter. Maybe we're a little bit lucky, but then you can have 10 dBm. Here it was 16. Over processing technology, that would probably be a little bit worse. But overall, you have good linearity now. But spread, especially for the IP3 of the inverter. Now, another way with active mixers to achieve this low RF gain and not kill the compression properties would be to take the noise cancelling LNA and then offer here a low ohmic impedance so that only in baseband you get again the filtering and the gain and the noise cancelling. So that's called the frequency translated noise cancelling approach that we proposed in this paper. And later this was also proposed with a passive mixer where the idea is actually identical, except that the common gate stage becomes a resistor, and this one becomes a kind of inverter stage, and the amplifiers will be around this RC network, and then you get this circuit by Murphy and Abidi, which actually, again, is noise cancelling. You can see that here. There's an auxiliary path. And this is also very low noise because of the noise cancelling and very highly linear because of the passive mixers, and also low 1/f noise because passive mixers have better 1/f noise, which is important for 0IF also. And also some noise gets cancelled off the op amp. So that was the active translated filtering approach. Let's now go to the passive approaches, where we concluded that we could not do much amplification and we need really filtering. So then start passive could be the design advice for strong signals. And that's what we typically do. We start with surface acoustic wave filters at a fixed frequency or an LC tracking filter, something like a tunable C with an inductor. But there are also more integratable, compact ways to do that, namely mixer first receivers and MPAR filters. And what is a mixer first receiver? Well, instead of putting the LNA first, we put the mixer now first. And you might think, why didn't we do that before? Well, people always thought that would be too noisy and there would be a lot of troubles. It turns out it is feasible if you use harmonic cancellation and optimize mixer duty cycle. And this would be a very simple case that we have published where you actually see the benefits of the technique. But we have just four non-overlapping clocks, four-phase clocks, with each a quarter duty cycle, 25% duty cycle. That's then the on time per switch. And actually, you get an I signal differentially and a Q signal differentially. So you can then make a 0IF receiver with I and Q. And under the assumption that RC time is big enough, much bigger than T on, we can show that theoretically this can have 0.9 dB noise figure. So pretty low. So low noise figure and highly linear because this is just a passive circuit and the switches can be low ohmic, so also low non-linearity. To understand these circuits well, it is good to distinguish between two regions, namely one where the on time is much bigger than the RC time, so gamma is then high. That would be actually this case here, gamma 20, where your signal immediately is followed. It's a kind of track and hold, you could say. So when the switch is on, instantaneously almost the output follows, and then it holds. And this is in complete contrast with the case where the gamma is small and the RC time is much bigger than the on time, so that in one RC time you can only follow the input signal to some extent, and only after a lot of cycles you will kind of follow to the really settle to the right value. And that corresponds to the peaky, very filtering behavior that you see here. This also has consequences for noise figure. So we have now two regions, the mixing region and sampling region defined on the previous page. And if we now take one kernel, just one RNC, we can analyze the noise figure and we see that the best noise figure is actually here about for 37%. But the 25% is pretty close, 6.9 dB noise figure. And now because we have, this is for a single path, if we have four paths, you can do IQ combining and differential combining. And every time you improve the SNR, every time you get correlated signal addition and uncorrelated noise addition. And then you can show that your noise factor for a polyphase circuit is the noise factor of a single circuit divided by n. And for n is 4, that means 6 dB. So then 6.9 dB brings you to 0.9 dB, the number that I showed before. So this is for the single kernel and for the digital side of the receiver after A to D conversion, this is a pretty good linearity. But it's only the mixer, of course. There will be amplifiers that add noise, but the mixer is very good. This mixer did not have any impedance matching, and often we want 50 ohm matching here at the antenna. Molnar's group from Cornell showed that you can also do that if you make your baseband amplifier with a defined input impedance. And you can also go to 8 phases. There's some advantages. Then you can do impedance matching. And you can also do a kind of harmonic approximation with 8 paths of a sine wave. So you have square wave mixing, but with multiple weights that you implement with these GMs. And then you can mimic a kind of sine wave at some sample points. And in that way, get rejection of the third order harmonic and the fifth order harmonic mixing. And in that way, get a wideband receiver that only converts mainly the fundamental. So here we have then good out-of-band linearity and compression and harmonic rejection, actually. But there are problems with some of the issues still. Now, frequency-translated filtering. So far, we were looking at receivers, mixing. And now we could also look at filtering. And it turns out that there is very old work already proposing this, where you take a low-pass filter in between two modulators, and that behaves like a bandpass filter. So we can see that also as a set of switches here, and another set of switches, and then low-pass filters. So if we start implementing it, we get this, RC filters with switches before and after. You could then realize if these switches have the same on time than this one, so S11 is the same as S12, then you could say move that switch functionality here and take the output there, and then you would get this circuit where you take the output here, and then you get what is called the so-called in-path filter, first proposed by Franks in ICC 1960, and we actually reinvented it 50 years later, but discovered this paper later. What is actually the essence of this M-path filter? Well, in essence, it's just a simple low-pass filter. And then due to the switching, it becomes a bandpass filter around the clock frequency. And because only part of the time the resistor is seen by the capacitor, there is a factor N increase in the resistors because each capacitor sees the resistor only a certain duty cycle and therefore a higher resistor. And if you now calculate the quality factor Q, which is the center frequency divided by the bandwidth, then we could have a clock of a gigahertz and a bandwidth of a megahertz, which means we could have a Q of 1,000, which we can never make with inductors. So the quality factor is very nice, whereas the center frequency is digitally programmable. So that is really nice for software-defined radio. Now, to get some intuition of how this works, look at the time waveforms for a sine wave with a frequency f in exactly equal to the switching frequency. But the switching frequency has 4 phases. And these 4 phases are here related to these 4 capacitor nodes. And then you see that essentially you just average over these parts And the average value shows up here at the input because it's mixed up again also. So you get then a kind of square wave approximation of that sine wave at the same frequency. And if we make the frequency 1.5 times higher, like here, then you see that this red one and this one cancels to zero. And also for the green ones that that happens. And that way we see that for this frequency something came out and here not. So in other words, we are filtering, and if you then do more deeper analysis, you find this shape. So there is indeed narrowband filtering, and it turns out you can model this with an LC filter, and the values for the R, C, and L are given there, and you can be found in our paper here where we derived that. What is the difference is that there are also extra responses in this case, the third harmonic, the fifth harmonic, and so forth. But those are, like in a comb filter, not that problematic. What is problematic, more problematic, is that if you now apply 3 times FS, it looks like FS. So you get a kind of frequency translation or folding, you could say, from 3FS to FS. So a bit of aliasing, like you could say. And these are the frequencies for which that happens. What you can do against that is make N higher and use some pre-filtering, like a low-pass filter, to get rid of the really problematic dominant high-frequency terms. Then there are some design considerations. Turns out you want this switch resistance very low, otherwise you limit your out-of-band rejection. Another solution would be to read out here with extra switches. There are different possibilities to do that. And also what's important, you want low overlap. It turns out that having clock overlap really kills the good noise and gain properties. So better have clock underlap in case of doubt than overlap. And this is then one of the first papers we showed, where you see that over a decade, from 100 megahertz to gigahertz, you can have the filter transfer and pretty nice out-of-band linearity and very good compression above 0 dBm and selectivities which are well above what the coil can do. And this was not even made for an amp-hour filter. Actually, it was the same thing as the mixer that I showed before. So Qs of 100 are feasible with doing these things. Actually, a competing group from Broadcom showed that you can also industrially use this for a GSM GPRS edge chip. They showed that this is good enough to achieve the so-called limit requirement that they need for certain standards. And then they do that by these switch capacitor techniques here. In each receiver path. So this symbol is then actually used for indicating where such an amp-hour filter is placed. So that gives then good enough noise figure and interference robustness without any passive filtering. That's the trick there. No external filters. This is all on chip. Now some recent innovations. First, going to lower power. So what we have now is a filter in a 50 ohm environment, and that means that the cutoff frequency comes from 50 ohm essentially and a capacitor. And so to make that megahertz, we need a very big capacitor. And also the switch resistance to be very linear, you want it to be much lower than 50 ohm. So that means a low ohmic switch and then big input capacitance of that switch, and that means high local oscillator switching power, the digital drivers switching on and off the switch will become an issue. Solution can be go to a higher impedance level. And how can you do that? Well, first, with a GM, go to another resistor value. And then here, maybe the input resistance was 50 ohm, but RO could be 500 ohm. So then you have 10 times higher resistors, and capacitor can be 10 times smaller. Or go to a kind of approach where you put that switch capacitor in parallel to a higher ohmic resistor like RF of a LN A, often you make an LNA with impedance matching to 50 ohm via, for instance, here, a 1 kilo ohm resistor and enough gain here in this well-defined gain in this loop. And then the capacitor has to filter with 1 kilo ohm instead of 50 ohm. So make this RF big also is a way to do that. And then with a filter in the feedback path, actually you can show it as a notch filter, this circuit, and then in the feedback path, overall it becomes then a bend path pass circuit. And there are two groups that publish this simultaneously, Radzavi's group and the group of Macau, of Lin and Mac. This is from the paper of Mac, where he also shows that at the input you already get some filtering, and certainly at the output even more. And the benefit is much smaller area, lower power. The disadvantage is that you do get some non-linearity from these GM blocks. Fully passive is also always much more linear. Then selectivity improvements. If we have an LC filter prototype like here, and we want to implement that with switch capacitor and path filters, each LC can be modeled with a grounded LC, and then coupled with GMs, gyrators, you can make in this way a steeper filter. So here you see a three stage MPAR filter with a very nice filter transfer function. So you have then improved RF selectivity by coupling these stages. What is important is to note that you really need a GM in between, so high ohmic input impedance and high ohmic output impedance. Otherwise, these switch capacitor networks, or actually these switch capacitor networks, would be just parallel capacitors, and then the order wouldn't go up. So that is an important point to remember for MPAR filters, that you want isolation between these switch capacitor tank, networks. I shouldn't say tanks, it's not an LC tank, but they behave, they can be modeled as an LC tank, provided you drive them with a high ohmic current source, like a GM, or load them also with a high ohmic voltage sensing amplifier. Now, another thing you can do is in baseband increase the filtering by extra switch capacitor infinite impulse response filtering. And then what you can get is more filtering and hence a better close-in blocking performance. That's has been demonstrated in this paper. That's in baseband then. Another thing that you could do is try to make the RF filtering more steep, but do this all with MPAR filters. And that's actually what we have been proposing, where you start with an upfront voltage-to-voltage passband filter here, and then convert from voltage here to current here. And then here there will be the baseband I to V conversion and extra filtering. And turns out that this works very well in the sense that in band we see resistors and you then get gain to the output because the signal is flowing through the resistors. But out of band, you can show that then the LC tanks, or actually the switch capacitor implementation equivalently, can be modeled like that, become active. And then you get a circular current path here, but also circular paths there, and nothing, or hardly anything, ends up at the output. And then it turns out that the filtering becomes steeper in that way. And also, because it's all passive, it can be ultra-linear. So that brings me to the next subject. How do we get very good linearity, even further improvement in linearity? It turns out that that filter that I was just talking about can be implemented like these two switch capacitors with a shared switch. And that switch is then around the virtual ground middle potential, because here we have, let's say, the RF plus and here the RF minus. So it's a balanced drive. And then the linearity can be very good. And why is that? That is because the filter now kind of has a switch capacitor with the switch connected to ground here. Whereas in the old, what we call top plate mixers, we had a switch connected between the input and the capacitor. So, and then the signal is still out of band. Here you have a lot of filtering, but then the signal is across this switch here. And the gate to source is modulated, or the gate to drain, by the input voltage. Whereas here, the source is grounded, and the drain, if the switch is low ohmic, also doesn't move a lot. And that's why you get in band about 10 dB better linearity due to this bottom plate mixing trick. And out of band, because you need only one switch, you can do switch sharing and get lower impedance, and that also brings better out-of-band linearity. And overall, this gives then record IP3 of above 40 dBm. Whereas the main disadvantage is that the parasitics to ground increase due to all the capacitors being connected to the RF node. Now, all these capacitors are connected to RF node, and here they were connected to ground. And that is the disadvantage that limits the bandwidth. Now, passive gain. That's another recent proposal. Actually, in our group, we worked on that. So I showed already this RF MPAR filter staircase approximation of the input sine wave, you could say. But if you look carefully, you can also see that red and orange are kind of equal but anti-phase. So we get here a red voltage and an orange voltage, which are kind of equal but different polarity. And this allows for reading out the capacitor, not here in the top plate, but in the bottom plate here, VA. And then you see in this moment here a connection which stacks these two capacitors with equal polarity. They add up, so you get 2x voltage gain by, yeah, we called it implicit stacking, because we didn't do anything extra. It was implicitly already in the circuit. However, we needed to realize that we should read out this node and not that node. So you stack then those voltages essentially implicitly, and you get 2x gain. And overall, that gives highly linear gain because there's no amplifier involved, and also very low power because there's no power involved. Yeah, the clocking, but not an amplifier. And what even makes it nicer in some respects is that you can also combine this with impedance uptransformer. And we know already that out of band IP3 from this work, we know that the ratio between this resistor and the switch resistor, or actually the other way around, is in the out of band IP3. So we want actually the switch resistance to be much lower than R. And it helps then if you could make that R artificially bigger. And we can do that with a transformer. A transformer transforms up R to N squared times R. In other words, with a transformer, we get more voltage gain, but also a higher impedance. And that even improves the linearity of this mixer further. And although the voltage gain limited a bit, overall we designed it such that linearity was maintained at about 25 dBm. And we still made a very low power mixer. So you see now that we achieve performance of traditional MPAR filters that needed 50 milliwatt at a bit more than 1 milliwatt. That's a very recent paper just out in JCFC, which actually, in this case, actually also can make 3x gain. It's possible to push it further. Then as a last point, I would like to mention spatial selectivity. So if a beam of even a set of antennas get a wavefront under a certain angle, then I think you can imagine that these waves, the blue waves here, arrive at different moments. And now if you align these clocks of the phases phi 1 to phi 4 right, then it for a certain direction they nicely align, and the capacitor here will see constructive addition of all these contributions. Whereas in the other case, for another direction, maybe for instance this direction instead of this direction, so that would be a steeper another direction for to the phased array, then you see canceling is possible. So you can make in this way also beamforming if you play around with the clock phases. And if you do that, we were able to show that we could have immediately at the antenna both filtering in the frequency domain and spatial filtering. So spatial and frequency domain filtering. And in that way, gain high compression points in the directions where the nulls of the beam pattern are positioned. So this is a good way to improve the interference robustness also. Yeah, now 1 hour has passed and I have lots of other material that I could talk about. I just included this slide with some of my favorite other techniques that I would like to talk about if I had another hour. But I just included and with some author names of, for instance, this is the Columbia group that works a lot on MPAR filters also. And certain for circulators, this one is an important one. For filtering by aliasing, this is an important author. Molnar, always from Mixer First. So if you are really interested in this field, I would say follow those people. And also recently for Millimeter Wave, Nick Nedjad's group has jumped on this also. In summary, an MPAR filter has a bandwidth that is defined by the RC time, the RNC then, and the duty cycle, and the center frequency by the clock. So it's high Q and programmable and very linear, programmable in frequency. Linearity is very good because it's all passive, and the compression point is, I didn't talk about it a lot, but has to do with the overdrive voltage. When your switch gets switched off by large swings, conduction stops and you have high, large signal compression. Folding is an important issue to worry about. And phase noise and LO radiations are other challenges that we are also working on to improve. Noise can be low. In-band, you have high impedance and low current noise and low one-off ref noise because there is no DC current in the MOSFETs. And the power essentially is the power that you need to drive the switches, which scales down with technology. So it is true that a very advanced technology is very advantageous. And make takeaways, flexible receivers give you less pre-filtering, and that means more interference. That means you need to do things to improve your interference robustness. For instance, linearization, canceling noise and distortion, avoid RF voltage gain, and combine it with baseband filtering. And exploit the frequency translated impedance filtering approach that I talked about. And if your input power is really high, let's say above minus 20 dBm, then you, I would say, need to start passive because any LNA starts clipping. So then passive pre-filtering wherever you can, whatever you can afford. Passive mixer first receivers could be a good idea. Or sometimes maybe also MPAR filters, if especially if you have already a receiver and would like to add the RF filtering part. And that gives you flexibility in frequency, very high IP3 and a good compression point. But there are certainly many other innovative application directions like circulators, equalizers, delay cells even, that also use these MPAR filters and MPAR mixers. And yeah, of course, I didn't do this work myself. Actually, I did hardly did that work. It's mainly the PhD students that I would like to acknowledge here. And also my colleagues with which we can have very good discussions. And people that have guided, or have also funded our research from different companies. Last but not least, I would like to show this 3D layout from our 3D viewer. If you are like this kind of pictures and you have your own layout that you would like to view and fly through, you can download the software to do this from this website. And also our papers are there. So you can, if you don't have expensive access to IEEE Explorer, our papers can be found there also. But the software is also very nice to show how the chip looks like, and with design reviews, it's also quite useful to see where all the layers are. And of course, it's also nice to show some pictures of the logos, our chips, always have a name starting with UT, University of Twente, and then something, yeah, in this case, MAD, or yeah, Sphinx, or the Twente Horse. Anyway, thank you. I hope you enjoyed the talk, and please come with questions. Or here the references, and another page with references.
Thank you very much, Eric. That was a really nice talk. You came to very in a very didactical way to show all these issues that we see in the linearity of receivers, right? And this was really, really nice. I think we have a very, very nice talk. I don't have many questions here. Of course, I have several questions of my own, and then I will start with one from the audience while the other people start asking as well, right? So Vinet A asked, I think you mentioned a little bit in the beginning of your talk, right? But he asked, why do noise figure depend on blocker amplitude? Is it because of gain compression?
Yes, that is at least very one very important effect, that that the gain then goes down, and that can be one mechanism. It can also be that it's a, like a mixing effect, that a very strong interferer mixes with phase noise. So both mechanisms can be causing this. Depends a bit on where the weak spot in your receiver chain is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, well, this is one of the questions, right? Going to the linearity issue, right? My question is about the in-band linearity and the out-of-band linearity. So this is a kind of tricky. Usually, when you want to measure that, and how do you trust the measurement that we are doing, right? Because when you are doing the out of band linearity, it always looks that you have a very nice receiver, right? But sometimes not. So what do you say about that? How can you check that, for instance, or?
That's indeed a very tricky thing. We bought special equipment also, especially a lot of filters, to make sure that we were looking at the linearity of our circuit and not at the linearity of the generators. Because what thing that easily happens is you do two-tone measurements. So you apply two tones, and they come from two generators, and then you use a coupler to bring that to the input. And that coupler, if that doesn't have reverse isolation, one tone is immediately talking to the other generator, and you have already your IM-free, but not in your receiver, but actually in the output stage of the power amplifier of the generators. Mm-hmm. So that's one tricky thing. So you want, I would say, always a lot of attenuation and also reverse isolation. So typically you use hybrids with isolation between the ports to reduce that thing. But we also often use extra attenuators. And also sometimes we have these very high Q passive filters, tunable LC filters, which are really extremely linear, 60 dBm IP3 or something, because it's just passive L's and C's and no switches. And then you can also make sure that sometimes you put a filter in between so that you don't get tones in the wrong path, especially for blocker noise figure measurements. That's also what we often use. But it's certainly true that it's quite tricky to do all these measurements, and that easily you might be looking at something that's more from the equipment than from your LNA, if it's or from your LNA is not so much a problem. That's typically fine. But MPAR filters, if they are really linear above 20 dBm, you really need to be very careful.
Yeah. So I mean, it's not only difficult to simulate and understand what you're simulating, but it's even more difficult to be sure that you are measuring right. Like,
yeah. But typically, you can easily find out because you can just see how things scale if by just changing the power of one port and putting in the attenuator behind it. For instance, you can make the power to the device and the test the same, because you put, let's say, you have two attenuators. One, you give more power, the other less attenuation, so that overall to the device and the test, it sees the same signal, but the coupling between the generators is different. And then you can see if it changes. If it changes, it's not good. And then checks like that.
Something is wrong. Yeah.
Yeah. So in that way, I would certainly recommend a lot of test measurements, and also maybe just take a very extremely linear mixer that you have in the lab and try to measure that one and see whether you get consistent results. Mm-hmm. Also, the spectrum analyzers give them narrow enough bandwidth that kind of things can also, and not too narrow, mm-hmm. so that you see maybe only part of the power. So lots mm-hmm. of things can go wrong there. And honestly, we also had to learn that by trial and error and making mistakes. And,
very nice.
It's inconsistent. Yeah.
Very nice. Yeah. I have also some comments here from Gilles Sonvich. Great talk, Vinet A, very interesting talk. RD, excellent tutorial. Thank you very much, Eric. And now one question from Sergio Bumpy, which was who was our former chapter chair, right? More than 25 years of key innovative on talks. So this was not really a question. Milton Klimak, thank you very much. And there is another question here. CMOS technology shrinks further. Do you think ADC first receivers will once become a reality? ADC first, instead of the mixer first, I mean the ADC first, like the dream that we have.
I think they are already a reality for some applications, but I would say it's mainly when the difference between the strongest and the weaker signal is well controlled. So for instance, I know that the DOCSIS cable modems that you might have at home for your digital television, if you have that, they do use kind of an ADC at the antenna. Actually, one of the spin-offs of our groups have developed such an ADC. That's about I think a 12-bit, 1-giga sample ADC with a lot of interleaved sections. But then 12-bit is enough because the difference between the stronger signal and the weaker signal is kind of under control. But if you have wireless communication, if you are unlucky, you want to receive at the same time a very weak signal, and there is a very strong interferer close by, and then you really need those 17 bits in some cases, and then it becomes really tricky. And so I think, yes, it becomes gradually, you see it shifting, but I have difficulty seeing that you can do it everywhere. And also, fundamentally, you could say, if you are just interested in a limited channel of, let's say, 10 megahertz, isn't it a bit of a waste then to sample that with 10 gigahertz? Because it's just a 10 megahertz bandwidth. So essentially, fundamentally, you can do with 20 mega samples, Nyquist sampling, and then you would go to 20 giga or so. Eh? That's 1,000 times overkill. Not to say that it's impossible, but for DOCSIS, because there are lots of channels. If you then want to digitize 100 channels, then it makes a lot of sense, maybe. So in a base station, certainly makes a lot of sense. But if you are in your telephone receiving one data stream with 100 megabits, then your battery needs to survive for some time, then it seems fundamentally also overkill. Yeah. So, and I'm not sure whether that's the way to go.
The power issue is very strong in this thread, and maybe if one day we can come up with ADCs that have dynamic range adjustable, like we have the AGCs on the receiver, right? Maybe we can have something, right? But we don't see that yet. There's a funny story about this. I was attending an analog class once, and then the professor told me, you see, we are putting the ADCs and the analog part in front of the antenna soon. So you will not have a job anymore, right? Because I was already on the RF. And then I told him, well, if they put the analog parts in front of the antenna, then you don't have a job anymore. Because it will become a RF as well, right? So
yeah. I also am old enough to have seen in the 80s that people said everything will become digital, and the end result was that was true. A lot became digital, but not to make the analog simpler or less. Actually, lots of interfaces are still needed, and because the analog design is much more tricky, it tends to need much more engineers to do that part than let's say the digital part, although certainly we don't want to underestimate it. For the big machines, it's also a huge job to make this digital run in a good way. But certainly we all need the analog.
Yeah, my success was really last year when a friend of mine that works on the digital, right? And I was just playing tricks, usually playing tricks on him and vice versa. And then he came to me and asked to help him on how to put the digital signal inside the ship, because he wanted a very high speed signal. And then so now we are talking.
Now we are talking. Digital design is also becoming analog design in some cases. And all the signal integrity stuff and all the coupling in the layouts, it's really very complicated and multidimensional. So I'm not worried that analog designers will be out of work soon.
Well, I have another question. Let's see in time. Maybe we see some other questions here. Yeah, there's another one here. Let's go with this one first. So some of the techniques you show are switched capacitors and other discrete time circuits. Do you think there is a tendency with sampling going further close to the RF side? This is from Fabio Kelp.
Yeah, I think that is the case indeed, that people are trying to do that. And actually, we've also tried to do some fundamental work in that. And at some point, we also thought it would be very challenging for jitter. So very often people say that. And in some conditions, that's also true, that sampling is the jitter, clock jitter is a big nightmare. So it's always something to worry about. But we were also able to show that if you look at the ADC requirements, we tend to say that we can only make one bit error, one LSB error, and then we do basic calculations, often in textbooks, that where you look like the biggest sine wave, and then what resolution do you need so that one bit of jitter doesn't mess up one bit. And if you do that calculations, you find the jitter is very, very tough. But we were able to show that if you, that's true, if any amplitude and any frequency can appear at the input. However, if you have a radio signal and spectrally it's not white, then it turns out that the requirements are actually overestimated if you do it like that. And we have a paper also demonstrating that. So, well, you can look it up if you look for jitter requirements and my name. My name happens to be very unique. So if you, there's no second Klumperink in electrical engineering. So then you can look it up. If you look at jitter and ADC and Klumperink, you will find a paper where we show that the requirements are similar to the reciprocal mixing requirements, clock requirements for a mixer. Mm-hmm. So, in other words, the jitter requirements of a sampling clock are actually not a showstopper in general. So, sampling on a capacitor can be done, but yeah, of course, the ADC is more than that. And but I think certainly sampling is possible, and then maybe some time discrete signal operations to reduce the dynamic range. I do see that is a feasible way forward also. And maybe in the end, at some point, immediately A to D converge, because A to D converters, to be honest, they improve faster than most of the other blocks. So in that sense, there's much more push there, but also fundamentally the trade-offs, yeah, some are really analog, but I think it's a little bit easier than, for instance, to improve an amplifier.
Yeah. Also, when you think about current sampling, for instance, And we are using very small devices because we want a high clock speed. Then we also reduce a little bit the jitter, right? Because you are not using big transistors and you're not working with voltage input as well, right?
And I'm not sure what you mean by current sampling, because it's current
charge sampling. I mean when you are sampling the charge, instead of the voltage, yeah.
Yeah, there's also some work from Finland about the charge sampling, where they show that it can fundamentally have some even better performance than voltage sampling, but the difference are not big. There's just a few dB. Mm-hmm. But certainly I think there are possibilities there.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I have another question. There is another one here. Let me see if I can understand. How is filtering by, this is from Anant Melavarigi, sorry for the spelling.
Uh-huh.
How is filtering by aliasing different compared to NPF filters?
That's a good question. This term filtering by aliasing has confused me a lot also. I've talked with Pamati also, and we kind of agreed at some point also that it's the term is maybe more like filtering improvement by allowing some aliasing to happen first, but then later cancel it by interleaving front ends. That's, I think, more precisely what happens. But I think if you want to just understand the basics, I would say just see it like a digital FIR filter, where you have samples that you weigh, and then a block of samples is then summed. Weight samples is summed, and that gives you one result. So you start with a high sample rate. Each of the samples gets a weight, and all the samples gets in a block added up, and then you at a lower rate, a subsample rate, you read it out. That is so. That's just an FIR filter with subsampling. That is actually the essence of what is happening, and in that sense, you could say it doesn't have much to do with MPAR filtering as such. But you can see some parallels. Pamati likes to see those where you can see MPAR filters spatially also do some weighing, and then there are some relations. But for me, it's more confusing to see them as MPAR filters than helping. I would just see it as an FIR filter, as I was describing before.
Okay, so, well, I have one last question before we stop the talk. This is one issue that I have once, right? I mean, we have a receiver and we want the selectivity to be very sharp. And we can have that with the NPF filters, for instance, right? But the questions, and of course, because of the transparency of the mixer, we have a very sharp selectivity at the input, right? But if you want a wider band signal to enter, so how can you deal with the NPF, for instance, if you want a wider signal? Because if it gets very sharp, then we start attenuating the some parts of the bandwidth of the signal, right? So how can we deal with that?
I didn't talk about that, but you can actually, if you have traditional MPAR filters, very easily make them programmable by just changing the baseband capacitance. Mm-hmm. And because it's all in baseband, and the switches that you need for that are kind of giving parasitics, which are also adding to that big capacitor, mm-hmm. I think that's not too difficult. Maybe the series resistance could be an issue. But you can make those amounts of capacitance variable so that you broaden up the bandwidth. But what is more limiting is that the shape, it's really always that low pass shape. And if you really want to play around with what you would like with LC filters, is kind of peaking of, and that mm-hmm. is kind of tricky to do. Then, as far as I know, you need some kind of gyrator or gem blocks that are the only examples that I've seen where they really were successfully getting a really nice filter shape, but then the nonlinearity kicks in again because the GM blocks are nonlinear.
Yeah, yeah. The problem is that when you play with the programming of the capacitors, then you have less rejection on the sides as well, right?
So that's true. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. What I want is a brick wall filter to put in front of the receiver, right? This is what we want, really.
But I think in the end, I think what you always see also in traditional receivers, in the end, it is a combination of some selectivity at the antenna plus some selectivity in the RF pre-filter plus some selectivity in the chip, then selectivity in the baseband, and then very sharp selectivity in digital. And that all together can do the job. But yeah, of course, we would like to move it all to the digital selectivity. But we are not yet there.
Thank you very much. With that, I think we answered the questions part. It was really really nice, really nice talk. Very very complete, I would say. We have a very very nice audience as well.
I'm glad that you enjoyed it. Maybe it is a bit specialistic for some people, but I hope they still get something from it.
We need to go there at some moments, right? So so if you want to do some final comments, I leave you to that. So thank you very much again for the presentation.
Yeah, thank you for attending, and it's nice to get this opportunity. So let's hope that we meet at some conference live again, not too far from now. That would be nice.
Thank you
hear
very
about
much.
More also about your work and all the things.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you everybody. With that, we close the session. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Bye.
Yes, thank you very much. Bye bye.